So this actually looks real. If the music was overdubbed, they are getting the movements correct with it anyway. So whoever trained them, if they're trying to play the part, it looks real enough to me, yeah. Hello, my name is Tony Makarome. I teach music at the Yong Siew Toh Conservatory and I play jazz bass. And I also play an Indian drum called the mridangam. Today I'm gonna react to some videos on jazz music and bass playing. So let's go. Yeah, this is really well done because the animation is basically in sync with what the musicians are supposed to be doing. So it looks like a real person's actually playing the piano and the saxophone. So the fingerings and the chords, they appear to be correct. So everything's timed really well. Even knowing that it's animation, you for a second forget that it is because it looks like real people playing. Specifically because the way people are playing, their body language and everything is the way that you would expect to see a real person play. As the music is unfolding, it's already happening, there's already a conversation going on. Sometimes the audience doesn't really realize that that's going on, so there's a constant discussion. Just like if you're playing in a game, a soccer game, that people are kind of looking at each other, there's a body language about, you know, where you're going to pass the ball and things like that. So those things are actually happening between the musicians. What you actually hear when they are obviously doing call and response is when they actually want the audience to be also involved in the game. So you do hear that happening, but in real life, there's constant communication between the musicians. Animation studios recently have shown an interest in the music scene and they're doing pieces where musicians are being involved. I think that's a great thing for the music industry as well, not just for animation or the film industry, because it brings into consciousness jazz music or whatever music's going on. It could generate interest in young people and maybe some people will get in touch with music and find themselves in it. Okay, so this is kind of a tongue-in-cheek take on jazz musicians playing notes that sound like they don't really fit in the harmony. The people who are not really listening to jazz a lot will always have the idea that something different is happening. For jazz musicians, there's a part of us that are trying to imitate the tradition. So the wrong notes that you hear may actually be wrong notes that have been played historically, and then we take it into our own. In the way that a rap musician, maybe they will pronounce English like not the normal way. Like what is happening becomes sapnin. So that's wrong English, but we use it, or they use it because it gives it a certain kind of flavor. So for jazz, it's the same kind of way. There are many notes that can be accepted into the harmony that may seem spicy or unusual for a listener of, like, you know, let's say classical music or pop music. So maybe for them, that's it. And on the other hand, jazz musicians are more open to spontaneous reactions to things. So if the drummer is doing something interesting, people can actually change the rhythm and things like that. So all those things are happening. So this video is kind of cute because I can't tell if he's making fun of it or he's trying to, he is a jazz musician who says, you know, this is what people think. So I don't know.
When they say that they, you know, hate jazz, they don't have context. They don't know where it comes from. You know, jazz was born in a little flop house in New Orleans, and it just, because people were crammed in there, they spoke five different languages, they couldn't talk to each other. The only way they could communicate was with jazz.
I don't think fully correct. When jazz originated, I mean, everybody was speaking English. Maybe, you know, in New Orleans, there were some French dialects as well, but verbally, people were able to communicate, but music was a different thing altogether. It was a style of music that came out of folk. A lot of times when there were funerals, there would be a band playing with the funeral procession up the hill. Then on the way back, everybody wants to go get drunk, so they start to do more happy music. So that is the sort of apocryphal explanation about where jazz is from. I think in the scene, he's trying to impress the woman, so he's kind of making up stuff. This actually looks real. if the music was overdubbed, they are getting the movements correct with it anyway. So whoever trained them, if they're trying to play the part, it looks real enough to me, yeah. Yeah, that's called Sing Sing Sing, by composed by Louis Prima, made famous by a clarinetist named Benny Goodman, so one of the legends of early jazz. A lot of people may think that the jazz is the smaller combo group, but that's because nowadays, commercially, you tend to see jazz musicians playing in a small combo, either in a club or at an event, just because people don't want to hire an orchestra. And this is called big band music. Big band music would be probably starting around the mid-1920s to the popular times would be till about the Second World War. The reason why the bands got cut down was because a lot of men started to get sent overseas to fight. So this would be big band music. It's still a legitimate kind of music, the same way that classical music, you know, you have Beethoven, which is a certain school of music, so. A lot of times when we play double bass, we do expend the energy, but sometimes it's not cool to look like you're working that hard. So it's always cool to look like you're not working that hard at all. The first guy actually was playing the actual notes that was coming out. And he actually has very good technique. He's got what's called German bow technique. He's actually playing it pretty well. The second guy is holding the bass really well. I'm not sure if he can actually play properly, but what he's actually doing is not actually playing the notes of the song anymore. So he could be their regular bass player, but then when they decided to make the video, they decided to do some kind of thing that makes the clip more memorable. So going crazy is one choice. Yeah, this guy is one of the best mridangam players in the world. The instrument is called mridangam, M-R-I-D-A-N-G-A-M. It's really hard to spell without actually seeing it. So it's a South Indian drum. Sadly, this drum doesn't get the recognition as much as it should because the tabla is more famous. The music that's being played is Carnatic music. What we were listening to is probably the drum solo, and during the drum solo, a lot of people get into the habit of just keeping time, and you can see the other musicians in the group keeping time for the mridangam player, and you can also see people in the audience. You can tell that they understand the music enough where when the drums phrasing, when it comes to a close, when it cadences, you can see people in the audience going like this because they're going 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and then they react to the excitement of predicting where the phrase is going to end. So that's all part of the excitement and interest in the music, so that gets people involved. So it's not just a drum solo where you don't know what's going to happen. In the tradition, there's a lot of sort of mathematical combinations in the air, and then if you understand enough of the music, you can actually follow it. It's interesting because Konakol is now, which is what they're performing here, which is that sort of South Indian art of vocal percussion. It's called Konakol, and it's starting to get a little bit trendy because it's on the internet a lot. And believe it or not, this happens to be an actual song called The Conference by an artist named Nitin Soni. It's actually a piece that he composed. So it sounds like people are talking together, so The Conference. It's very effective for this particular ad, very, very catchy. The funny thing is if you're not exposed to South Indian music or Carnatic music, you don't really understand really the form of it, but what you are reacting to is really how fun the language sounds. It sounds like somebody being very nervous and trying to like fumble around. So I think this commercial itself is called Fumble. So in a way, it's funny, so it's effective because it sounds like somebody go, oh, I don't want to drop it. So it sounds like somebody going like that. But the actual forms that they use, it's just like rhythms. It's like almost like if you're a drummer, you're going tum tum ta tum ta tum ta tari kada tum tum ta ko tum tum tari kada tum ta. So it's that, but like a faster version. Tari kada tari kada tari kada tum tum ta. You know, and it's really interesting because Carnatic music has this sort of rhythmic solfege, but it's also a performance medium, which is unlike anything else in the world. Like for instance, if you learn Western music and you go do re mi, you don't actually perform do re mi in public because you sound strange. But this is a way to pass down like drum solos or phrasings to other musicians, going, yeah, what I'm playing is dim, takida dim, takida dim, takida dim, takida dim. Then they go, oh, okay, tum, takida dum. They play whatever it is. So it's a way to communicate with drum syllables or percussion syllables. So, but it's also a medium of performance. So you'll see performers articulating this instead of playing it on the instrument. Thanks for letting me share my love of jazz and Carnatic music with you today and reacting to these videos. It's been kind of fun. You notice that the common thread between all kinds of music is rhythm. So there's really, even though you're doing Indian and jazz, there's a connection because rhythm is a language that everybody understands. Even people who don't understand classical music know ta-ta-ta-ta, you know, the rhythm just appeals to you. So it was fun to do this reaction tape, and I like to thank the people who invited me to do it.